In the previous lecture, we have looked at the origin of magnetism in transition metals. We have seen that magnetism emerges when the reduction of Coulomb interaction upon splitting the band structure exceeds the corresponding gain in kinetic energy. This is the essence of Stoner criterion. Now we are going to look at how magnetism changes, behaves at interfaces and surfaces. In such situations, the density of state is modified locally, which opens the possibility to enhance magnetism. Let's see how it works. You remember from the previous discussion that magnetism emerges in metals when the product of the Stoner exchange energy and the density of states per atom exceeds 1. This means that for a given electron-electron interaction, the narrower the bandwidth, the more likely magnetism is to emerge. Now, let us take a two-dimensional crystal lattice for the sake of the demonstration. If I adopt a single orbital tight bending model, something I discussed in the previous lecture, I find that the density of states looks like a cosine function with a bandwidth of about 8t, t being the hopping parameter. If I reduce the dimension of my system and consider a one-dimensional chain of atoms, the bandwidth reduces to 4t. This is simply coming from the fact that I have removed some of the nearest neighbor hopping so that the electron is now confined in one dimension. Therefore, it is more localized and its density of states is narrower. Finally, in the atomic limit, the density of states is nothing but a Dirac delta function with zero width. What these three cases show is that reducing the dimension of a crystal from 3 to 2 to 1 dimension reduces the density of states. Based on Stoner criterion, this means that small objects, but also surfaces, are more likely to display magnetism than bulk materials. This is something you can confirm easily using density functional theory, a numerical approach that enables computing the magnetic properties of materials, accounting for all the orbitals involved in the valence bands. Here I show a picture computed by Stefan Blüger's group in Germany. They show the magnetic moment of isolated transition metal elements on their corresponding moment in the bulk. When considering isolated atoms, we retrieve Hund's rule, which states that magnetism is larger in manganese and chromium because they possess the largest number of unpaired spins in their valence shell. But if we look at the magnetic moments obtained in the bulk version of these transition metals, we see that the magnetic moment is overall reduced for the full series and even vanishes for titanium and vanadium. While iron, cobalt, and nickel show a reduced but decent ferromagnetism, manganese and chromium displays antiferromagnetism based on the Bethe-Slater rule discussed in the previous lecture. These calculations confirm that narrowing the bandwidth and therefore increasing the density of states results in enhanced magnetism. There is another very beautiful demonstration of this idea that was published by Billa, Chatelain and Deher in Science in 1994. The authors measured the magnetic moment of small clusters of nickel, cobalt and iron. They observed the systematic increase of the magnetic moment upon reducing the size of the clusters. You can also see some sort of oscillations that are probably due to quantum confinement effects. Let us continue our journey in the land of transition metals and consider now what happens for the 4D and 5D metals. If you remember last lecture, I showed already how Stoner criterion varies across the transition metal series. You see that this criterion is smaller than 1 for all 4D and 5D elements. However, you can also see that it is not too far from 1 for palladium and platinum. Therefore, one can imagine that platinum and palladium could become magnetic if we reduce their dimension. And this is indeed what happens, as shown by these density functional theory calculations. This figure, also calculated in Blücher's group, shows the magnetic moment across the 4D and 5D series when deposited in monolayer or as an isolated atom on a silver substrate. You see that when you deposit an isolated atom at the surface of silver, there's a good chance this atom becomes magnetic. In particular, molybdenum and tungsten are predicted to display a very large magnetic moment of more than 3 μB. On the other hand, palladium and platinum do not show magnetism, which contrasts with the hand-waving arguments given by Stoner criterion. Well, this discrepancy simply shows that the orbital hybridization that gives rise to magnetism can be quite complex, and one has to carefully account for the orbital overlap between the ad atom and the silver orbitals. But qualitatively, the idea of symmetry reduction giving rise to magnetism or to enhance magnetism works fairly well. In addition, if you replace the ad atom by a monolayer, then the symmetry increases, and magnetism is much less likely to appear in 4D and 5D materials. In this case, only rhodium, iridium, osmium, and ruthenium display magnetism. Now, what happens when one deposits a 3D transition metal on top of a 4D or 5D transition metal? Since there is symmetry reduction at the interface, one expects the magnetic moment to increase, of course. But what happens is actually even more interesting. First, have a look at this figure that represents the density of states of a series of transition metal interfaces. On the left, you have rhodium cobalt, palladium cobalt, and silver cobalt. And on the right, you have iridium cobalt, platinum cobalt, and gold cobalt. The blue shaded area is the density of states of the cobalt monolayer deposited on the top, and the red shaded area is the density of state of the heavy metal. The first thing you see is that the density of states of rhodium or palladium overlaps pretty well with that of cobalt. It means that the orbitals of rhodium or palladium hybridize strongly with the ones of cobalt. On the other hand, if you look at silver-cobalt interface, the orbitals of silver are located far below the Fermi level, so that their overlap with the orbitals of cobalt are weak. Similarly, iridium and platinum orbitals hybridize strongly with cobalt, while gold orbitals hybridize weakly with it. This simple observation tells you that the material that hybridize strongly with each other will tend to merge their properties much more efficiently than material that hybridize weakly. Let us now look at the spin and orbital moments of the system close to the interface. First, consider the top figures that display the spin magnetic moment across the interface. As a reference, the dashed horizontal line shows the value of the freestanding cobalt monolayer, while the solid horizontal line shows the value of the bulk cobalt. So the magnitude of the spin magnetic moment of cobalt in the case of an interface doesn't change much compared to the freestanding case and slightly increases compared to the bulk value. But what is more interesting is that the heavy metal itself becomes magnetic. This induced magnetization depends on the hybridization between the magnetic orbitals and the heavy metal orbitals. And it is therefore maximum for palladium and platinum and vanishes for silver and gold. Second, we can now consider the orbital magnetic moment given in the lower panels. You see that the values of the orbital magnetic moment of cobalt is larger than the value in the bulk due to the presence of the interface. So in other words, when bringing two transition metals together, the heavy metal has a tendency to become magnetic, while the magnetic metals acquires enhanced orbital momentum. I'd like to emphasize that the orbital magnetic moment remains 10 times smaller than the spin magnetic moment. So it does not significantly participate to magnetism, but it does contribute to other phenomena such as the magnetic anisotropy, the Joseon-Skimori interaction, or the Rashby effect. I would like to conclude this part by mentioning three remarkable experiments that take advantage of Stoner criterion to control magnetism of transition metals using gate voltage. As we already said, magnetism depends on the density of states at the Fermi energy. So applying a gate voltage at the surface of the metal can lead to a tiny modification of the number of electrons at the surface. This very tiny change, about 1% of an electron, can lead to dramatic modification of the magnetic properties. This was first demonstrated by Dominique Givol's group in 2007. They considered a system where ionic liquid was deposited on the surface of iron platinum. This ionic liquid has the ability to accumulate positive charges or negative charges at the iron platinum surfaces, depending on the voltage. This accumulation results in a modification of the local electron density and therefore leads to a change in the magnetic properties. The figure below shows a branch of the hysteresis loop measured at various voltages. You see that the coercivity, and therefore the magnetization and the anisotropy, change quite substantially. This pioneering experiment has triggered massive interest for the gate voltage control of magnetic properties. Another beautiful experiment has been achieved in Teruo Ono's group. Here, they use a thin insulator rather than an ionic liquid. And they were able to observe a modification of the Curie temperature as a function of the gate voltage. Of course, we are just talking about a change of a few Kelvin when applying a voltage of about 10 volts. This change is tiny, but measurable. Recent progress in this direction has resulted in the full voltage control of the magnetic anisotropy, and even dynamical switching of the magnetization using voltage pulses. Finally, let me say a few words about a third experiment achieved in Tokura's group in Japan. Here, they apply the same idea, but replace the bottom electrode by platinum. Then they measure the Hall effect of this platinum layer as a function of the gate voltage. In the right figure, you see that the Hall effect appears when turning on the gate voltage. So you don't see any Hall effect at zero voltage, you just have the ordinary Hall effect. And when you turn on the gate voltage, you see that there is some anomalous component building up. This means that the interfacial platinum is brought beyond the Stoner limit and becomes magnetic, displaying anomalous Hall effect. The authors estimated that the induced magnetic moment can be as large as 10 μb, which is gigantic. So we have seen that magnetism can be enhanced at surfaces and interfaces. What I would like to discuss now is the physics of two very important phenomena: magnetocrystalline anisotropy and Joseon-Skimori interaction. These are two very important phenomena for interfacial magnetism. So let's jump to the third part.